What do you do about a crazy state highway that's just slammed with traffic?
The kind somebody would be a fool to try to cross on foot.
You know, like me.
How the heck am I supposed to cross this?
This is State Highway 37, north of Indianapolis, and at rush hour, it's a total mess.
And there's no official way to get across here, because it's a highway.
But even people driving their cars wait for long red lights. The town next door had a cloggy highway like this.
There were no pedestrian crossings. It was a bit like the Great Wall of China.
How they fixed it for cars and pedestrians without widening it at all.
Notice you have to be pretty aggressive around Carmel to get in these roundabouts, you know?
Last time we talked about how Carmel, Indiana has 150-something roundabouts, more per capita than anywhere else in the Western Hemisphere. But to the south, the city of Indianapolis doesn't have any.
You get roundabout everywhere over there.
You like them?
No.
No? How come? I really don't get it. I just talked to an Uber driver back there, and it said, you like the roundabouts in Carmel? And he goes, no, I like light.
When Carmel tried to build roundabouts along 96th Street, right along the boundary the two cities share, Indianapolis sued Carmel because part of the circle was on their side.
His roundabout is on my half.
The trial judge ruled, technically you are building in another city and you kind of need another city's permission to build in their city. But you're both cities. Take this out of court and settle it.
Today, Carmel curves 96th Street away from Indianapolis, so the roundabout sits entirely in Carmel. And that curve actually slows cars down and makes the roundabout even safer, funny enough. But you know, Indianapolis's dislike of the roundabout is a bit ironic, since America's first traffic circle is this one.
Monument Circle, here in downtown Monument Circle here in downtown Indianapolis.
There you go.
Something like 200 years ago, the state of Indiana planned to put the governor's mansion here and have a big circular road around it. Apparently, they did such a poor job building that governor's mansion that no governor ever lived in it.
Instead, it holds a monument to soldiers from the Hoosier state who served in war.
It's William Henry Harrison. He died in 30 days.
But just because a road is big and round doesn't make it a roundabout.
The people entering the circle have the right of way. The people already in the circle, they had to wait. And that was fine in the days of horse and buggy, but in the days of motor cars, sometimes you'd have so many people entering the traffic circle, it would back up until nobody could use the circle.
Monument Circle may be bad for traffic control, but it does make a really good gathering place in the center of Indianapolis.
But what the city's done is shut down half of it so people can hang out all weekend.
But on a work day, everybody jumps into their cars, leaves work, and man, quite a few of them pass through the city of Carmel on their way north. And that was giving Mayor Jim Brainerd a real headache.
A high-speed highway that divided our city. We had these big stoplights, and because it was a state road, they wanted to move the traffic on their road. So crossing it on our surface on the city streets, this might be a 4 or 5 minute wait for that green light and get 20 seconds. It really wasn't working very well, and it was congested. It was one of those typical suburban sprawl situations where you go from one light to the next.
When traffic gets so crowded that not all the cars are making the green light, engineers can try to buy more time, try to make that green light a little bit longer for the busy street, but then now it means all the other drivers are stopped at longer red lights, and as they wait, more cars show up in their lines, which means they now also need a longer green light, which they can't have because we gave all that green time to the other street. So you think, okay, well, we'll just stretch the whole cycle out, make it twice as long. But now that's twice the time, so twice as many cars show up in line and don't have enough time to get through, so we're right back to where we started. And it's just a fact of physics. You can only push so many cars through an intersection during a given amount of time. Well, if you can't have more time, what about making more space? More lanes means more cars through that precious green light.
Somebody's complaining about congestion. So here's what I normally hear, though, from other mayors, and city council members, city engineers. It's a typical civil engineering answer. Let's add lanes. Well, that doesn't move cars through an intersection any faster.
Well, the North Valley of Albuquerque tried it. This is Coors Boulevard. As more houses got built, more people started driving down this street, and more people got stopped by red lights.
I mean, this is just getting stupid.
Sometimes waiting for two or three red lights before they'd get through.
Never gonna make a surface level arterial street move a freeway level's worth of traffic.
But it's not that the state of New Mexico isn't trying. Look at how wide that street is. But if you have a sharp eye, you might notice a problem. It's rush hour, but half of the pavement is empty. When a red light breaks up the traffic flow, a really weird phenomena happens.
When the light turns red, all the drivers start stacking up there.
And because the through traffic is stopped,
the road this way isn't doing anything. Half the time, the road is just empty.
It's not really getting any work done until the light turns green, and then the road becomes very busy again, at least for a little bit. You know, it kind of reminds me of a heartbeat. Compare this with the way traffic flows on a highway with no stoplights. Engineers call this uninterrupted flow versus interrupted flow. The way the cars are moving on streets with stoplights or frequent railroad crossings or lift bridges or, you know, anything that breaks up the traffic into clumps. And engineers call these clumps platoons. On the plus side, sometimes engineers can adjust the traffic signals just right so the platoon you're in gets a green light at the next light and the next light. Like this fun video a viewer sent in, engineers call this signal progression. But the downside of platoons is that inefficiency we talked about. At any given time, half of the cars are stuck waiting for the light, which means the other half of the street is sitting there mostly empty.
All it does is create a bigger parking lot to get more cars through the green cycle of the light.
Widening the intersection may help cars through the green, but widening the street between the intersection just helps bring more cars to the intersection, where they have to just sit there and wait for the inefficient red light. Check out this expressway in Fremont, California. During busy hours, it moves about 5,000 cars in each direction. And with a couple of stoplights on it, that means a very wide road. A freeway lane can move more than 2,500 cars per hour, which means if you got rid of the stoplights on this road, you could narrow it down to two lanes in each direction and move the same amount of traffic. A highway doesn't have to be fat to be fast, as long as you don't keep stopping the traffic. So you're probably starting to put all the pieces together in your head about the story of how Carmel, Indiana was about to make the state of Indiana not widen the road, and the state was going to pay Carmel millions of dollars to not widen the road. To make money off YouTube, I have to post a video every week. Thanks to AI, that is going to be easier than ever.
That doesn't sound like me at all.
Ever, ever, ever. But thanks to you, I can stick to making real videos that take a little bit longer.
Are you on the news?
YouTube, actually.
Oh, that's cool. Good luck with your video.
Thank you.
The 1990s were good for Carmel, Indiana. Business was booming, people were building houses and moving in, and everybody was driving on Carmel's Keystone Parkway and breaking it.
It was impossible to walk across as a pedestrian or cyclist. It would be taking their life in their hands to cross.
Nobody's expecting me because this is not an area where they're expecting pedestrians.
To get traffic moving again, the state of Indiana was ready to spend $20 million to widen the road, because that's just what you do when a road gets clogged up. And Carmel was ready to fight that.
Paving is really expensive too. You know, it costs for a two-lane road from scratch $12 million a mile in the Midwest.
The problem was that there weren't enough lanes. The problem was those red lights. If you can make those go away, these lanes work a whole lot better.
So Carmel's mayor sat down with the new governor.
So I called him and I said, I think our DOT is making a big mistake, and he got involved.
So the two of them sat down and put together a deal.
The state of Indiana just gave the highway away, said, okay, Carmel, this road's yours now. In fact, we'll give you $100 million to take it off our hands. The catch being,
we ended up taking over the road forever.
Carmel would own the road now. Carmel would have to fix it. Carmel would have to maintain it. But it's okay, because the mayor had an idea up his sleeve.
Get rid of the stoplights along the parkway. How do you do that? You turn it into a freeway. The state of Indiana had ruled it out because it's expensive to build a bridge over the freeway or over the cross street. And when the freeway ramps are too close together, there isn't enough space for cars trying to make left turns. Both sides are stuck between the ramps, which means you have to buy more land so you can push that diamond shape out as wide as you can. And at Carmel, that would mean buying out a whole bunch of houses. Now Carmel said, well, we have a better idea. Don't do a diamond interchange. Do a roundabout. No, not one on the ground. That wouldn't work on a major highway. They'd break it. Put the roundabout elevated up in the sky.
Well, I saw those actually in Mallorca, the island, Spanish island off the coast of Spain. And so I showed it to a consulting engineer. He said, you know, bridges are expensive. We could do this with one bridge, not two.
So they took the circle and squished it in the middle, like a barbell or a peanut.
Only one bridge at $8 million a bridge compared to two at $16 million. So that's why we went with the design. It's a much more compact design, too.
And compact is key, because nobody's making left turns conventionally. The ramps can be close together, which means they can fit it all into place without really buying out any houses. Saves money and makes the people who own those houses a lot happier.
When the project wrapped up, those six stoplights that were breaking up the traffic were all gone, all replaced with overpasses with those peanut-shaped roundabouts.
Both of these engineering models show the same amount of traffic on Keystone Parkway.
It plays with your mind. You don't think of this as being a big, busy intersection. You think, oh, there's just not that much traffic. But if you look at the traffic counts, this would be a very busy stoplight. I think the psychology is, oh, it's a big intersection because you see a lot of stopped cars, but if everybody's moving, you think, oh, it's just a small town. It's not a big deal.
Making the street uninterrupted flow works like magic.
Helps the traffic move really smoothly now, and also not just for cars.
Because Keystone Parkway crosses underneath the city street, you hardly know the freeway is even there.
Guess if you're going to make somebody climb back up a hill, it might as well be the person with the engine, right?
And unlike crossing at a normal freeway ramp, where people get excited and start gunning the gas through the crosswalk, the tight turns of a roundabout force every car to have to slow down to 10 or 15 miles per hour, which is objectively safer, but more importantly, it doesn't feel as scary to cross the freeway interchange. So people actually do.
It's now safe. You can walk across it. We haven't had a fatality. We had one medical fatality where I think a fellow had a heart attack or a stroke. But with that one exception, since 2007, we have not had a fatality in that road where we usually had one to two per year.
By the way, Highway 37, which I used at the beginning of the video to show you kind of what Keystone Parkway used to be like, travel a bit south of where I was, and you can see that that town is copying the idea. And even the state of Indiana, when they went to widen U.S. Highway 31 on the west side of Carmel.
Must have won over a few engineers with the state. They copied it. It's exactly the same. Not quite as fancy looking, but it works basically the same.
But roundabouts haven't just been good for people driving cars in Carmel. They also seem to be transforming the town into the kind of place where people are actually riding their bikes. Next time, how a town not that far from the Indy 500 might have stumbled onto the answer to make cars and bicycles into friends. Hey, we now know what California's going to do when they run out of license plate numbers. What is going on in New York? First they were tolling, and now they are not tolling every car that rolls into Manhattan. Those and your questions coming up with a Behind the Scenes podcast, coming up exclusively for contributors like you who help pay for these videos at patreon.com/roadguyrob.